מסכת ערכין, page 20, we are 9 lines from the bottom of page 19b. It's not what you said, it's how you say it. We learned so far in ערכין that there are two categories. One, if a person make a vow in regards to values of something else, and he pointed out and he said, I commit myself toward certain entities, or the other one is something related to even himself, but connected to detail, to items such as weight, heights, and more. Now, the value is something that many times hard to measure. Why? Take a simple example. God forbid someone was born with attached fingers. There is no amount of money that he or she willing to pay in order to separate the fingers so they'll be able to function properly. With that said, how much is the value of a full person? How much you evaluate someone who lost part of his body, let's say hand, by someone else? You go by the value prior to that and the value in the future, or you compare some people with the same profession and you see the amount of average income versus the job or tasks, as we learned in the past, that they can do today. Ba'ei Rava, again, page 19b, 9 lines from the bottom of the page. Rava asked a question based on the Mishnah in Tractate Sanhedrin at the very beginning. They said that they, over there, that the valuation of a person for the whole notion of making a neder for a vow, it has to be by 9 rabbinic judges and 1 Kohen, versus the valuation of someone for the purpose of damages is performed by 3 rabbinic judges. So Rava asked a predicament, a dilemma based on that, and he said, Ba'ei Rava amaduhu omed shel nezakin. So Rashi explained to us that a fellow, let's call him Reuven, he was damaged by Shimon, and the rabbinic court assessed him by assessment of the damage, which, as we explained, the 3 rabbinic judges of the Bet Din. Ve'amar damai alai. And he says, my assessment is incumbent upon me. Mahu, how you treated. Rashi explained to us, he didn't say erki alai. So therefore, if he said erki alai, we have a clear statement without any need for assessment. But he commit himself toward his vow to give the valuation of that. Mi amar ha'amadu chada zimna? Do we say this? Said that his assessment was already assessed one time for damages. So therefore, that's the amount we are expecting to donate. Or Dilma, or perhaps you say, Shane umdena devei asara me umdena devei tlata. It's a different in assessment of 10, remember, 9 plus 1 Kohen, versus assessment of 3 rabbinic judges, and as a result, it's necessary to repeat the assessment with 10 judges. Im timtza lomar shane umdena devei asara, me umdena devei tlata, if you really tell me that the assessment of the rabbinic court of 10, 9 plus 1, is different than one of the 3, so therefore, that's the reason why we require the person who make a vow to do it second, to do the assessment second time. So therefore, there is a question can be raised. Amar damai alai va'amadu, v'chazar v'amar damai alai mau. So if he said, my assessment is incumbent upon me, and he repeats it, so the question is, do you hold him Hacha vaday amadu b'dei asara? You assume that he is certainly assessed by 10 and you don't need to have another second assessment. Or dilma, or perhaps there is a concern. Why? Shachach, shavach beineu beinei. That in the interim, in between, there might have been an enhancement of his assessment. And therefore, since it was a difference between the two, there is a need to do it again. And moreover, if you tell me that maybe his value enhanced in a time in between, אם תמצא לומר, either according to שיטה מקובצת, שבח ביני וביני, or שני אומדנה דווי עשרה, אם תמצא לומר, sorry, ולא עמדו וחזר ואמר, דמי עליי מהו, if you tell me, he said, my assessment is incumbent upon me, and rabbinic court did not yet assess him, and then before the rabbinic court assesses him, he again said, my assessment is incumbent upon me. Mahu, what exactly is the halacha? Hacha vadai, do we say that here, for sure, page 20, bechad zimna amdinan lei? O dilma kevan de baze achar ze nadar, tre zimna amdinan lei. Do we say that we assess him once, and he donated twice the value of one single assessment, or you say that since he vow in a sequentially way, we assess him twice? ואם תמצא לומר כיוון דבזה אחר זה נדר, since he did it in a sequence way, one after the other, תרי זימני אמרין עלי, so we say that it's twice incumbent upon me, so you take it as a two assessment. אמר שני דמי עליי בבת אחת מהו, so he said my assessment twice in incumbent upon me. What exactly the הלכה? אחה ודאי בבת אחת נדר, בבת אחת עמדין עליי. או דילמה כיוון אמר שני בזה אחר זה דמי, since he said בבת אחת, he vowed at the same time, you take it as assessment only once, combination, or you can say that since he used the word twice, so it's a vow sequentially, and therefore he must have the assessment twice. אם תמצא לומר כיוון דאמר שני בזה אחר זה דמי, עמדו מאליו מהו. So they assessed him on his own, which means not for the purpose of assessing a vow. מאמרינן העמיד מאליו וקאה, או באינן כוונה לאומדנה. You can say that he stand by the assessment on his own, or you could say that we require an assessment to be performed with a clear intent for the whole notion of consecration to the temple treasury. So the Gemara said, Pshot mi hachada, that not. So you can resolve from the way that we said in the following Mishnah. Dmei alai v'met, he said it's incumbent upon me to donate my assessment, and then he passed away. Lo yitno yorshim she'en damim lametim. His heir, his children, doesn't need to give that assets to the temple treasury, because there's no monetary value for the dead. So the assessment of the time of his vow is unknown. So they said, again, let's understand it. אם תמצא לומר כיוון דאמר שני כזה אחר זה דמי, המדו מאליו מהו. If the ten assess it, just to know, מי אמרין אני העמיד מאליו וקאיו, דילמה באינן כוונה לאומדנה. Need to have intent to do assessment. So in part, he said, פשוט מהחדה, דתנן, דמי עליי ומת לא ייתנו ראשים שאין דמים למתים. ויסק על התח המדו מאליו הווי ומדנה. So if you tell me if the ten assessed him on his own, it is valid assessment with regard to his vow. Ha'amid vekai. So even if he makes a vow before he passed away, in some measure you can say that his yorshim, his heir, needs to give something to the Hekdesh, something to the temple treasury. How? Mi'ika gavra delosha ve'arba'a zuzim? Is that possible to see a person who is not worth, at least in those days, a full zuz? Which means that the you see here proves that the assessment is required to be performed with intent for the sake of the consecration to the temple treasury. So they rejected it. Amru me'elav nachit le'umdana. Damai alai lo nachit le'umdana. So they said, if there is an assessment has actually been performed, it's one thing. However, in the case of one who says, it's incumbent upon me to donate my assessment, and then he is no longer among the living, he has not entered into an assessment, which means you don't have an actual assessment conducted at all, as the way Rashi explained. Rabbeinu Gershom said that you need to know the exact in full value, otherwise it's like שלא נעמד כלל, that it's never have any definition. The חידושי הגריז expand on that. Anyway, משנה הקדושה. חומר בערכין מבנדרים כיצד? They are more stringent when it's come to valuation than with a vow of assessment. How? האומר ערכי עליי ומת, ייתנו הירושים. דמי עליי ומת, לא ייתנו הירושים. שאין דמים למתים, as we explained earlier, if a person said it's incumbent upon me to donate my valuation and then dies, so his heir must give the valuation to the temple treasury. However, if he said it's incumbent upon me to donate my assessment and then die, then because there's no monetary value for the dead, his children doesn't need to bring anything. ערך ידי, ערך ידי וערך רגלי עליי, לא אמר כלום, he said, the valuation of my hand, the valuation of my leg, nothing. ערך ראשי וערך כבדי עליי, נותר ערך כולו. He says, the valuation of my head, valuation of my liver, so he gives the valuation of his entire self. זה הכלל, that's the basic principle, דבר שהנשמה תלויה בו, נותר ערך כולו. Anything that it's, without that organ, that part, the body cannot survive, so the valuation has to be for the entire self. חצי ערכי עליי, if he said half of my valuation, נותן חצי ערכו, he needs to bring a half of his valuation. ערך חצי עליי, the assessment of my valuation of half, נותן ערך כולו, the entire self. חצי דמי עליי, נותן חצי דמיו עליו. Half of my assessment, he give half of assessment. דמי חצי עליי, נותן דמי חוליו. The assessment of my half of me, he give the assessment of the entire self. זה הכלל, the same principle, כל דבר שהנשמה תלויה בו נותן דמי כולו. Anything that the bodies depend upon, meaning without that part the body cannot survive, he needs to bring to give the entire self. האומר ערכו של פלוני עליי ומת, if he said it's incumbent upon me to donate the value of someone else, so and so, and both the one who vowed and the one who's been object to be vowed passed away, hanoder itnu hayorshim, the heir of the one who vowed must give the valuation of the object of the vow to the temple treasury. Damav shel ploni alai umet hanoder itnu hayorshim, he says that the assessment of so and so upon me, so and that person who commit that vow passed away, so the heir needs to give his assessment to the temple treasury. Met hanidar, if the object of the vow dies, לא ייתנו היורשים, the heir doesn't need to bring anything, שאין דמים למתים, the same as we said, there is no monetary value for the dead. תנו רבנן חומר בנדרים מבערכין, שנדרים חלים על במה חיה ועוף, ונדונים בהישג יד, מעט שאין כן בערכים. The sages told us that there are halachot, but are more stringent when it's come to vows of assessment than of the valuation, because the animal, the undomesticated animal, and the bird, so and they are not assessed based on the affordability. So this is not the case when it's come to valuation, because the evaluation, the assessment based on whether the one who vows can afford to pay what they vowed. חומר בערכין בנדרים כיצד? They are stringent when it's regards to valuation more than the regard to vow of assessment. How? אמר ערכי עליי ומת, he says, my evaluation upon me and he passed away, יתנו יורשים, the heir needs to pay, דמי עליי ומת, לא יתנו יורשים, שאין דמים למתים, as we said earlier, that there is no monetary value for the dead. אמר ערכי עליי ומת, יתנו יורשים, שמאמינם מלווה על פה גובה מן היורשים. So we derive from that, that they, if one collects a loan by oral agreement from the heir, so, and is no promissory note that was written with regard to his obligation, so he needs to collect from the heir, שנהחה, here is different, why? Because the מלווה כתובה בתורה, that the loan, the debt, is written in the Torah, which means that according to the deceased age and sex, at the time of the vow. שמאמינה מלווה כתובה בתורה ככתובה בשטר דמיה. You mean to say that the loan that was written in Torah, which is any time that the person makes any financial obligation that applies by Torah law, is considered as written as a document. So here the Gemara rejected that and said, "Acha maskan kshamad bedin." Here we talk about the case that he really stood in judgment before he passed away, so the rabbinic court obligated him to donate his valuation. So that ruling of the court is considered like a financial obligation written in a document, and therefore the yorshim, the heirs, are required to pay his valuation. דכוותה גבי דמי עליי שמד בדין, עמי לא יתנו יורשים. If that's the case, then the corresponding situation with regard to one who said it's incumbent upon me to donate my assessment, the braita must also be referring to one who stood in judgment. Amai lo itnu yorshim. So why don't the heir have to donate his assessment? Damai alai mechusar umdena. It's incumbent upon me to donate my assessment. So the assessment of the precise amount he must pay is still lacking. Erki alai, my evaluation, if he stood in judgment and the court obligated him to pay, mechusar velo klum, nothing is lacking, because the amount he pays is fixed by the Torah. Erech yadai veragli alai, amarav gidel amarav venoten damei, I must give assessment of the forearm or leg. והלו אמר כלום קטני, we just learned that it doesn't say anything. So the answer is, לא כאמר כלום לרבנן, according to the sages, it's not considering nothing, but דמיה, when it's come to the assessment, it's followed the view לרבי מאיר, according to רבי מאיר, that hold that the person not say a statement for a note, and therefore he must have intended to vow to donate the assessment of the lien, and therefore no valuation of the lien. Ha'asra Torah, ha'amra chadazim, ha'amara chadazim, ha'amar rav gidl amar rav, ha'omer erich kli hazeh alai, noten damav. If someone said, I give the valuation of this vessel, he must give the assessment. So ma'u detayma ha'tamud adam yodeh she'er erich lekli, a person know that there is no valuation of the vessel, וגמר ואמר לשם דמים, and he therefore intended and said his vow for the sake of the assessment. אבל אחה, but here when it's come to forearm or leg, מתעקתי, he made a mistake. Why? He thought, לסבר כי איך דעיקה ערך ראשי וערך כבדי, כנם ערך עדי, ערך וערך עגלי. He thought, the same way as they have the value of my head and my liver, same way as applied to hands and leg. אבל דמי לא כאמר, but he didn't say, intend to say the value of assessment. So therefore, Rav Gidl teaches us, Kamash Malan, that even the case that one who vowed to donate the valuation of the forearm or leg, he did not speak in error, but intended to donate the assessment. ערך חושי וערך כבודי נותן ערך כולו. מי תמה, נפשות כמה רחמנה. To us in Leviticus 27, verse 2, the word the living people. So therefore, if it's the life of a person dependent, as we said earlier, without that part, the person will die, so he must give the valuation of the entire self. The Mishnah further teaches us the aklal, that's the principle, דבר שאני שומע תלויה בו, להקטויי מן הארכובה בלמעלה. So that's to include from the knee and above. Person will die if his leg were severed above the knee. חצי ערכי עליי נותן וכולי תנו רבנן. חצי ערכי עליי, half of my valuation, נותן חצי ערכו. רבי יוסף רבי יהודה אומר לוקה ונותן ערך שלם. He says that he received מלכות and he must give the full valuation. לוקה המי, why he received flags, מלכות? אמר רב פאפה לוקה בערך שלם. He flag, he punished. In that he must donate the full valuation. מי טעמה גזרה חצי ערכיית הוא ערך חציו וחצי ערך חציו. הווה דבר שהנשמה תלויה בו. The valuation of half of him is something that's really the soul of a person, the life, is dependent. חצי דמי עליי נותן וכו'. דמי חצי עליי נותן דמי כולו מי טעמה. So here the quotation, Leviticus 27 verse 2, נדר בערך נפשות כתיב. To us said, when a man shall clearly utter a vow with regard to evaluation of living people, because the verse juxtaposes vow of assessment and valuations, so thereby teaching that it just as one who takes a vow of valuation when it's come to an item upon which the soul depends must give the valuation of the entire self, the same way as someone who takes a vow of assessment with regard to an item so which the soul is dependent, he must give the assessment of his entire self. זה הכלל דבר שהנשמה תלויה בו, להטוי מן הרכובה ולמעלה. תנו רבנן, אמרי חצי ערך כלי. If someone make the valuation of half of the vessel, רב מאיר אומר נותן דמיו, רב מאיר says, he must give the half of the assessment of the vessel, וחמורים לא אמר כלום, the sage said it's nothing. רבה חלש, one time רבה became sick, ולגבי הבאי ורבנן, the abaye and the sages went to pay a visit. ויד וכאם רב, they come and they ask, ביש למה רב מאיר כסבר אין אדם מוציא דבריו לבטלה, לא שענה כלוב, לא שענה חצי, according to me, we understand that the person not utter a word in vain, so there is no different whether he vowed to donate half its valuation or the entire valuation. In the case, he must have intended to donate the assessment, and therefore there is no valuation with regard to vessels. אלא רבנן מאי כסברי, אי אדם מוציא דבר לבטלה, אפילו כולו נאמר, if it's a person not utter something in vain, so even the entirely, ואם אין אדם מוציא דבר לבטלה, if a person not utter a statement for nothing, so then, אפילו חציו נאמר, so even one who vowed to donate half of the valuation of a vessel should be obligated to give half of the assessment, אמר לו רב אביי, רבנן דהא כרבי מאיר סברי לי, here they hold the same as רבי מאיר, וסברי לה כרבי שמעון. סברי לה כרבי מאיר דאמר אין אדם מוציא דבר לבטלה. אז they hold the same as רבי מאיר in that sense that they hold, the person should not express his any statement in vain. So therefore one who vows to donate the valuation of a vessel must give its assessment. וסברי לה כרבי שמעון דאמר שלא יתנדב כדרך המתנדבים. That if you remember, we studied it in Tractate Arakhin, page 103, that the person did not donate in a manner of typical of the donor. So the same way here, kulei orchei litnadvu vei palgei lav orchei litnadvu. So the typical way to donate the entire vessel, that's the common. Versus if it's not typical manner that one donate half of a vessel. So therefore, one who vows in this manner and not say anything, and therefore is exempt. Omer el koshel ploni alai umet. Some said the valuation of so and so, and unfortunately he passed away. Hanodel, the one who make the vow, mainu shamat bedin, that he stood in judgment. So therefore the rabbinic court obligated him to donate his valuation before he passed away. So the court ruling is considered like a financial obligation, that it's written in a document, and therefore his yorshim, his heirs, have the obligation that have to pay the valuation. Hainu hach, that's basically the same the previous clause in the Mishnah. Is trichle, we needed damav shel ploni alav umet hanoder. If someone said that the value of the assessment of so and so is incumbent upon me to donate, and the one who make that vow passed away, yitnu ayoshim, the heir must give this assessment to the temple treasury. Page 20b, ma'u detema kevan de lo amadu lo ishta'abud nichsei. You may say that although the one who took the vow stood in judgment before he passed away, and the rabbinic court obligated him, since the object of his vow was not assessed before he died, the property of the one who vowed is not lien to the dead. Kamash melan, so therefore the heir doesn't have the obligation to pay. So the Mishnah teaches us, kevan de'amad badin ishta'abud ishta'abud nechsei, since he stood in judgment, his property is under the lien. Giluyei milta be'almahu, so it mere disclosure of the matter, which can be performed after the death and of the one who vowed. Mishnah Kedosha said, sho ze ola, if one said, this bull is consecrated as a burn offering. Or ubayit ze korban, this house is consecrated as an offering. Umeta shor venafal habayit, the bull died, the house collapsed. Patur milashlem, is free from fulfill his commitment. However, in a case of one who says, it's incumbent upon me, shor ze alay ola, ubayit ze alay korban, the bull is burn offering, or it's an incumbent upon me to give this house as an offering. Meta shor venafal habayit chayav lishlem, if the ox passed away or the house collapsed, he is obligated to pay its value. Amar Rabbi Chiya Barav lo shanu ela de amar dmei shor ze alai. He said that the monetary value of these bulls is incumbent upon me. Aval amar shor ze alai ola, see how important is the language of expression. If he said that this bull is a burn offering, kevan de amar ze umet eino chayav b'chayotu. Since he used the term this, he said this, thereby referring specifically to that animal, so and the bull died, he does not bear financial responsibility for the loss. Alay lahavi'o ke'amar, he said, it's like saying it's incumbent upon me to bring this bull as an offering to the temple. Meiti ve'ishor ze ola, ha'shor ekdesh u'mo'alav bo, meto nignav ve'no chayav b'chayito. Shor ze alay ola, so again, alay ola, so this bull is burn offering upon me, incumbent upon me, ashor ekdesh u'mo'alim bo. So the ox is consecrated, and therefore the one who benefits from it is liable for misuse of consecrated property. Meto nignav, passed away or been stolen, he bears financial responsibility, chayav b'chayuto, for the loss, despite the fact that he did not vow to give the monetary value of the bull. So you see here a contradiction. So Gemara answers and he said, "Mi alim ani matidin dokima de kamar dmei hachana me damar dmei." He says the value of this bull as a burn offering. Vehamid de seifa de kamar dmei reisha de lo kamar dmei de katane seifa dmei shor ola ashor chulin ven moalim bo metu nignav ve lo chayav b'chayuto abal chayav b'chayut damav. You have the obligation of the monetary value of the bull in his vow. So Gemara said, Reisha v'seifa dekamar dmei, Reisha demar yakdish ashor ledamav. The first part is one said that lets the bull concentrate for its monetary value, and therefore the bull is consecrated and he bears financial responsibility for its value. However, v'seifa dekamar, the last part is referring to one who said, Lichshiavo damav yikdashu, when the bull, come in time that the bull shall be sold, the monetary received for the sale will be consecrated for the use as a burn offering. So the question is, why an adam makdish davar shelo ba la'olam? So how come a person cannot, and we study it in several places, if you remember in the Shas, for example, Mishnah in Kiddushin 62, so a person cannot consecrate the entity that has not yet come to the world, and therefore one cannot consecrate the money that you'll receive in the future for the sale of the bull. אמר רב יהודה, רב המני רב מאיר, אמר אדם מקדיש דבר שלא בא לעולם. That's followed the Rav Meir that said that it's possible that a person can consecrate an entity that's not yet come to the world. יקדע אמר לרב פאפר לאבאי, ואמר לרב רמי בר חמה לרב חיסדה, כרבי מאיר דאמר, אדם מקדיש דבר שלא בא לעולם. The person can consecrate something that's not come yet to the world. So אבאי said to him, rather אמר לי ואלא כמן. So according to whom? To who else opinion could be the bright or be? Certainly is followed the view of Rabbi Meir. I would like to conclude with something in a way relates to halakha, and it's a in regard to a common question when you have a lease of a apartment or house. So there are two ways. There are a lease that said you lease specific house, and it's a lease that just speak about potential house. So if it's a general potential house and that house unfortunately collapse or broke or whatever happened, the obligation of the owner in those cases can be that he needs to give him a substitute house. But if he said, I commit myself to rent to you, to lease to you specific house, so if something happened to that estate prior to their lease, there is a notion, halakha, that is not obligated to give him a substitute, a place. The question is, what happened if the landlord himself ruined the estate? So according to the Rambam, is no difference between this house or just general by its zeh or by its tam, is no difference between the two. He has the obligation to give him a substitute estate, versus the Rabbeinu Nissim, even the tenant ruined the estate, if it was an obligation to a specific house, he doesn't need to give a substitute. But the Rambam derived from our Gemara, because we said that if you have a house that have this negatzarat, and the Kohen basically broke it, so the landlord needs to give him a substitute place to stay, because the Rashi explained that negatzarat caused because of the tenant, that it either was a miser or is a thief, etc. So it's like himself, according to that Rashi, is the cause for that damage. There are many rabbinic writing over the cause of the leprosy in the state. So the question is that the sin of the landlord, that is the sin of the tenant? But the clear car in his interpretation of Parashat Metzora and our sugya, you can derive some conclusions that it's mainly the transgression of the owner.